Welcome back to Pattern Recognition. So today we want to talk a bit about regression and different variants of regularizing regression. So you see here that this is the introduction to regression analysis. The idea here is that we want to essentially construct a linear decision boundary, and in our two-class set, this would be then sufficient to differentiate whether we are on the one side or the other side of the decision boundary, and therefore we compute the signed distance alpha transpose x plus alpha 0 to that particular hyperplane, and then the sine function just tells us whether we are on the one side or the other side of this decision boundary, as we've seen in the previous Adidas example. So now the idea is that we can compute this decision boundary simply by least square estimation. And the idea here that we want to follow is that we essentially convert our entire training set into a matrix and a vector, and here the matrix is given by the individual feature vectors transposed, and we add a column of 1 in the very end. So this gives us the matrix X, and this is then a matrix in an M times D plus 1 dimensional space. So D is the dimensionality of our feature vector and M is the number of training observations, and this is then related to some vector y, and in this vector y we essentially have the class memberships of the respective feature vector. Now we want to relate those two with a parameter vector theta, and theta now is composed of the normal vector alpha and our bias alpha 0. Now how can we do the estimation? Well, we can simply estimate theta to solve the linear regression problem. So we essentially take the matrix X, multiply it with theta, and then subtract it from Y, and take the 2 norm to the power of 2 and compute the minimum over this norm with respect to theta. And you can see then we can break up this norm and build the least square estimator. So we can write also this square either as a sum over the individual components, or we can break up the L2 norm squared with this product of the two terms and transpose. So this is essentially an inner product, and it doesn't matter which solution you take. If you now take the partial derivative with respect to theta and do the math, then you will find the solution of the so-called pseudo inverse. So this is the very typical Moore-Penrose pseudo inverse that is given as X transpose X, and this inverted times X transpose times Y. So this will essentially be a solution that will give us an inverse which will enable us to compute the parameter vector theta from our observations X and Y. One thing that you have to keep in mind here is that this will work if the column vectors of X are mutually independent. If you have dependency in the column vectors, you will not have full rank, and then you will run into problems. One way how to solve this then is you take the singular value decomposition, then you can still do it. And another way is, of course, that you apply regularization. And we will talk about the ideas of regularization in the next couple of slides. So the questions that we want to ask is, why should we actually prefer the Euclidean norm, the L2 norm? Why is that actually the case? Will different norms then lead to different results? Which norm and decision boundary is actually the best one? And can we somehow incorporate prior knowledge in this linear regression? And this then leads to the concept of ridge regression or regularized regression, where we extend the objective function with an additional term. And for example, you can constrain using the Euclidean length of our parameter vector theta. So you could then say that you have a linear regression with the log likelihood penalized by minus lambda theta transpose theta, so the L2 norm of theta, and you set lambda to be greater to zero. Or alternatively, as an actually we will see equivalent formulation, you could say we extend our estimation with a prior distribution on the parameter vector theta, and we assume theta to be distributed in a Gaussian way where we essentially have a zero mean and a diagonal covariance matrix with some factor tau square as the variance. Okay, so this is a bit much. Let's look into the details, how we can actually see that this is true. We start with the regularized regression and we use the Lagrangian formulation here. So you see that our constraint that our norm should be small is simply added with the Lagrangian multiplier in here. And then we can see that we can further rearrange this. So we can again express the norms as inner products using this transpose notation. And this then allows us to compute the partial derivative with respect to theta. And again, I can recommend to do the math on your own. You can have a look at the matrix cookbook. So this is also a very good exercise to practice with because you will see that you find the following solution. So you set the partial derivative with respect to theta to zero, and then you solve for theta, and this then essentially gives you the theta hat, and theta hat can be computed as x transpose x plus lambda the unity matrix and the whole term inverted times x transpose y. So if you compare this to the classical pseudo-inverse, you see that we essentially have only the lambda times the unity matrix. And this essentially means that you're adding a small positive constant on the diagonal elements. So this is all that your ridge regression is introducing in this case. But this has a very nice result because then the problem is non-singular even if x transpose x is not full rank, because you add this small constant to the diagonal and this will cause your problem to suddenly have full rank. Very interesting approach to do this, and this actually was the main motivation of ridge regression when it was first introduced in statistics in 1970. So this way you can stabilize your solution and you will always find a full rank matrix here, and this is a very nice way to regularize your solution, and we'll see that you can actually apply this regularization ideas not just for regression but in many, many different optimization problems. And this is a very classical way of getting difficult, unstable problems into some constraint domain where you actually can get the solutions also robustly. The ridge regression solutions are not equivariant under the scaling of the inputs, so you should standardize the input before solving the regression problem. And one approach could be that you essentially not penalize the intercept alpha zero, and this can be done by centering first the input using the mean of xi, and then you estimate first your alpha zero by some estimate of the average of your classes. So this is essentially an average of the prior, so you compute the mean over the class memberships, and then you can go ahead and estimate the remaining coefficients by a ridge regression without the intercept, which means to actually solve the problem again by using this matrix X, but you already set alpha as a constant, and then you solve it on a d-dimensional problem. So you have now d columns instead of d plus 1, so we are not adding this column of 1 in the very end. So this is also in relation to statistics, and actually we can also consider our parameters alpha j as random variables. And now let's suppose that our actual observations, the yi, they are normally distributed and the actual decision boundary is the mean. So you have the alpha transpose xi plus alpha zero, and this is then modeled by some variance sigma square. And now the parameters AJ assume to be independent of each other. So we model this essentially using a unit covariance matrix, and then this leads to a prior distribution of the AJ with a zero mean, and then essentially for every J a standard deviation of tau square. So let's assume these things, and this then allows us to go ahead and write this up essentially as a normal distribution for both of the cases. One is mean free, the other one has essentially the decision boundary set as a mean, and then we can go ahead and use a maximum posterior probability. So we can see now that we want to maximize the probability of alpha given the observations yi. Now we can of course apply the Bayes theorem, where we rewrite this then as the probability of observing alpha at all times the probability of observing y given alpha, and this then can be rewritten. We can split up the product here and see that the prior on the alphas is only dependent on the dimension, whereas the probability on the yi's is dependent on the number of observations. So we can split the two terms up and write them up as a multiplication, and then we can go ahead and apply our trick with the log likelihood, and the log likelihood then yields us essentially a maximization of the logarithm of the priors on the left hand side, and then the logarithm of the p of y given alpha of the constraint probabilities on the right hand side. So now let's use our Gaussian assumptions here, and you see that this will essentially cancel out the logarithm. We remove all of the terms that are independent of alpha because they're irrelevant for this maximization, and then we see that we simply have on the left hand side the square of alpha j summed up and scaled with the variance of the parameters here, and on the right hand side it's essentially the sum over the distances to the decision boundary, and this is then also summed up over all of the observations and scaled with the respective variance in this distribution. And we see this is a maximization, so it can multiply this also with a constant. So let's multiply this term with minus 2 times sigma square. This will convert this entire thing into a minimization, and you can also see that the 2 will cancel out and we just have one factor, that is sigma square over tau square at the first term on the left hand side. And now if you look very closely, you can see that we can bring this again into our matrix notation that we used earlier. So we can see that this is essentially the inner product of the alpha vectors, that is the first term. We can then replace the sigma square and tau square as lambda. So we suddenly bring in our variable lambda again, and the right hand term is again this 2 norm. So you essentially see that the ridge estimate that we talked about earlier with the L2 norms is essentially the mode of the posterior probability density function if we assume that they are distributed with Gaussian normal distributions. So this is linked. Okay, this is already a pretty cool observation. So if you're preparing for the exam, this is really something that you should be aware of. So let's go ahead and look into other forms of regularization. So we've seen that the ridge regression is using an L2 norm, but obviously we can also use other norms for the regularization of our parameters, and the so-called lasso is a very typical choice that is then applied to the parameter theta. And the idea of lasso is that you are trying to get sparser solutions for the parameter vectors, and this is very often used to compute sparse solutions of the system of linear equations. So you try to achieve a large number of zero elements in your solution vector. You want to have only very few non-zero elements. So what did we learn? We learned about principal component analysis. We used linear discriminant analysis with and without dimensionality reduction. Both PCA and LDA are computed using eigenvector problems. you just have different matrices on which you apply them and a different form of normalization on the process. And of course, for the LDA, you will always need the class membership, because otherwise you won't be able to compute any kinds of inter and intra-class covariance matrices. We brought in two alternative formulations. So we have the rank reduced one and the Fisher transform. That is the classical approach of formulating the problem. And we looked into linear and ridge regression methods for classification. And this then already brings us to the next lecture. So in the next video, we want to talk about different kinds of norms. So you've already seen that if we look into the lasso, we suddenly had this L1 norm popping up. And I think at this point, it is highly relevant that we discuss the properties of different norms and which effect they have actually on the optimization. So you see, we now kind of formalized a lot of the basics, the actual optimization problems, and in the next couple of videos and lectures, we will look into how to actually optimize these problems very efficiently. And therefore, also regularization is a very big deal. And in order to understand regularization, you have to understand the norms that we're actually regularizing with. So I do have some further readings. Again, the best-selling book in the last decade from SIAMS is the Numerical Linear Algebra, the Matrix Cookbook. You've seen we are using this at various occasions, really useful to find very good matrix identities, and then also the basics on discriminant analysis in the elements of statistical learning. If you got interested about our applications, you see here the work by Björn Escofier with classification of perceived running fatigue in digital sports, which has been presented on ICPR, the International Conference on Pattern Recognition, Tampa, Florida. Also, one nice thing about science is that if you can travel, conferences typically take place at very nice locations. So Tampa, Florida is definitely worth going and having a conference there. And the other topic that we talked about in applications was the shape modeling. And this you can see in the paper by Martin Spiegel. And there they essentially were presenting this kidney modeling approach with active shape model generation techniques. And this was presented in Computerized Medical Imaging and Graphics in 2009. So I also have some comprehensive questions, and I hope they can help you with the preparation of the exam. So thank you very much for listening.